All right. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go right to a video that will help to set up our next panel. And it is on the Bidote. We are going to be going into stories and narratives of those who walk with the water. And we begin with stories that will be coming from the Dakota people. So we'll begin with the video, and then Emily will step right back in to introduce our panel members.
This is the center of the universe, the center of all things. We are at a place that my people, the Dakota, call Bidote. This particular Bidote is very significant to many of the Dakota people, because they believe that this is the spot where the Creator made us. He used parts of everything that you can see around us here, the trees, soil, some of the fish, some of the birds that are flying by. That's one of the reasons why we have this connectedness to all things. Mitakuye Owasi, and that means everything is related. We used the river valleys as our homes because we had fresh water right there. We had the use of the river where we could fish, we could gather wild rice, and we could travel almost anywhere, as far south as the Gulf of Mexico, as far east as the Ohio River Valley, as far west as the Rocky Mountains, up all the tributaries that bleed into the Mississippi River. We could find locations where maple trees grew. We could do sugar mapling in the springtime. The water, of course, is sacred, but all water is sacred. We believe that the water is, in a way, the blood of Mother Earth, and it helps everything to sustain. Everything is alive. All things have spirit, even the rock. Respect these things because it's all we have to fall back on.
All right, Emily, it's over to you.
Thank you so much, Myra, for sharing that video with us. The next segment
is... The Louisiana Department of Wildlife and Fisheries has been...
The next segment is Those Who Walk with the Water, Stories from the Gulf to the Headwaters. And the focus on this is storytelling. So we're not going to do a formal Q&A for this, but if you do have questions, you can post those in the Q&A, and we'll see if our presenters might be able to get some of those for you in the chat. And this is coming to you in two parts. So the first presenters are going to come as a pair for you tonight. I'd like to welcome John Shepard and Maggie Lorenz to join me on the screen. Hi there. And John is the Associate Professor and Assistant Director of Hamline University's Center for Global Environmental Education. His acclaimed multimedia writing, education, and creative video storytelling is largely focused on the intersection of nature and culture. And John, I'm actually going to turn it over to you to go ahead and kick this segment off.
Okay, thank you so much, Emily. I love seeing that video. That location, Bidote, is quite close to where I am now in St. Paul, Minnesota. It is truly a historically significant confluence. My partner in this presentation, Maggie Lorenz, will be able to tell you more about that. but I just want to say, by way of introduction, the program that I work with, is really dedicated to storytelling and helping people connect more deeply with landscapes, with the natural systems that our lives depend upon, with understanding the connections between those systems and human societies and human actions. So really that nexus of nature and culture. So when we look out our window where we live, what we recognize immediately is that the land surrounding us is Dakota land. For us, it is a great honor to be able to work with Maggie, with others in the Dakota community to help to hold up the stories of the land. And, you know, our understanding, our way of thinking about our world is that, you know, we are storytellers as humans, and our relationships with landscapes, with waterways like the Mississippi, are deep, and really are their meaning comes from our experience over the years, our relationships with one another as community members, but also with these sacred places that surround us. And so it's really our mission is to help to encourage people to think more deeply about the lands and waters surrounding us and understand their history, our own communities, and our relationships with them. So that's what I would say by way of introduction. Again, just an honor to be here, and we're going to be sharing some stories. The one that you just saw is one of the stories from our program, which is the program we're going to be sharing with you is called Exploring Dakota Lands and Waters. So that's one of the videos that kind of kicks off the experience about the place called Bidote. And with that, I'm honored to turn it back over to you, Emily. Do you want to do the next introduction?
Yes, thank you. I would like to introduce Maggie properly. Thank you very much. And is my camera, there it is. Camera wasn't on. Maggie is an enrolled member of the Turtle Mountain Band of Ojibwe and also descends from Spirit Lake Dakota Nation. She's the executive director of the Lower Phalen Creek Project and Wakan Tipi Center and chairs the parent committee at Bidote Learning Center, where she also has a daughter who attends first grade there. So she's got a personal connection in multiple ways. And I look forward to hearing what you have to share with us, Maggie. Thank you.
Thank you for that introduction, Emily, and I'm really happy to be here today. I'll just say good evening. Chante washte nape chiusapie, Maggie Lorenz and Maki apie da makota ye, and Nijaska Edwati. So I greet you all, my relatives, with a warm handshake and a warm heart, and I am Dakota. I live here in St. Paul, which is traditionally known as Nijaska to a Dakota community, which means white bluffs, which speak to the white bluffs along the Mississippi River in the St. Paul area. This is a traditional historic name for this area. And I'm the executive director, as Emily mentioned, for Lower Phalen Creek Project and Wakan Tipi Center. And so our work primarily focuses on the green spaces on the east side of St. Paul, which is a majority BIPOC community and has a lot of culturally significant sites to Dakota people, including burial sites, sacred sites, village sites, and a lot of other really rich cultural history. And, you know, St. Paul, Minneapolis, for those of you who haven't been up here, we truly are the Twin Cities. It's just a stone's throw from one another. And so my daughter attends school in Minneapolis at Bedote Learning Center, where she where she's learning Dakota language through an immersion program, where my husband teaches Dakota to middle school students. So I'm really happy to be here and share some of our work that we're doing to restore the lands, the waters, restore relationships, like John was mentioning, relationships that people have to these spaces, and restore some of these stories that have nearly been lost through colonization. And I'm really excited about the program that we're going to share with you a little bit today, that we've really worked pretty hard on over this past year to bring some of these virtual experiences to students and community members virtually through the pandemic. And also, you know, once we share those, the program, we can talk a little bit more about some of the some more stories of our work. So hand it back to you, John.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. So I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen so you can get a sense of what we're talking about here, and give you a little bit of an orient. Hang on one sec. I think I selected the wrong window. Hang on. Okay, there we go. So this is our, I'm gonna make this a little larger so I can see better what I'm doing. All right. So again, this interactive experience is something we've created. The program I work for, the Center for Global Environmental Education with Hamline University, and the Wakan Tipi Center and Lower Phalen Creek Project with Maggie. We also worked collaboratively with the National Park Service and with a state park, which is in this region. The National Park Service actually administers, there is a national park along the Mississippi River through the Twin Cities, and it's known as the Mississippi, I always have to remember, Mississippi National River and Recreation Area. It's a 70-mile stretch of the river as it flows through the Twin Cities here. And so they're a partner with this project as well. And it's part of what we're sharing with you now is part of a larger program that is being used in schools in the Twin Cities. Also, it's being shared with the public on large interactive museum-grade computer kiosks. So we're using multiple ways of getting these stories out into the community. With that said, I want to just give a little orientation to this interactive experience so you kind of know what it's about. And then Maggie will kind of lead us through viewing a couple more, some of the content that's here. So this is an interactive map, the left side of the screen, produced by a Dakota artist, Myra Miles, and a beautiful hand-drawn map of really it's the rivers flowing through the Twin Cities region. So you can see City of Minneapolis is represented in the left here. St. Paul is on the right. The Mississippi River comes down from the top of the map and then makes a sharp curve, flows up northward again near St. Paul, downtown St. Paul. Wakan Tipi Center that Maggie works with is represented right here. And then it flows down out of the bottom right-hand corner of the map. And the other river coming in from the bottom left here and joins the Mississippi is the Minnesota River. So this area called Bedote is the confluence of the Mississippi and the Minnesota rivers. And as Leonard Wabashaw in the video we saw a minute ago explained, and as Maggie can talk more about, it is this considered to be the point of origin for the Dakota. So it is a sacred place. And it's also really a center place in the Twin Cities in so many ways. There's a little icon here for a stone building with an American flag. That is the first military presence, U.S. government presence in this region historically. It's Fort Snelling built at the confluence there. There was a major and exceedingly tragic conflict between the Dakota and whites living in this area in 1862. In the aftermath of that, there was a concentration camp built on in the Bedote area on the island of the confluence that housed women and children, Dakota women and children, over a horrific winter. So it's a place of tragedy, but it's a place of rebirth and renewal at the center of our city. So there's much going on there, many stories to tell. So I'll just say a little bit more and then ask Maggie to kind of walk us through sharing some more of these stories. So the map itself, we have these circled red areas. Each one of those, we have place-based stories, videos produced by, almost all of them by Dakota creatives, a few that we produce collaboratively with members of the Dakota community. And then the legend on the right lists all of these locations, and there's little audio buttons by everyone where you can hear the correct pronunciation in Dakota of these place names.
Wakan Tipi. Bedote. Wita Tranka. Kheata Otume. Kap Ozia.
So, and that is Maggie's daughter, Madison, who is did the recording. So this has involved her family there as well. So I will pause there. Maggie, do you want to give folks an orientation and maybe kind of guide me, and I can click on the locations we want to explore?
Sure. And I just also noticed that Tracy joined us. So Tracy, I don't know if you just want to take a moment to wave or maybe introduce yourself a little, your name and role with the project, and then I can go into the map.
I'll be very brief. I apologize for getting hung up a little bit, so that's not my intent, but I know you two could handle this quite well. I do most of the things behind the scenes anyway. I'm the executive director of the center, and pleased to be here, and I'm going to let Maggie keep going. We feel that giving voice to the unheard and seeing the invisible is really important, and I'm very proud of this project for bringing this to life, specifically for some young people. I teach a class where there is teachers and adults, and most of them are not familiar with the story of the Dakota. And that's a travesty, and we're all working together to try to change that. So with that, Maggie, please take off.
Thank you so much, Tracy. John did a great job of setting this place here where we are. This is Minnesota Makoche, Dakota homelands. The Twin Cities here really is the place of genesis for Dakota people. So we don't have any other place to call home. This is it. This is our homelands. And so our creation story comes from the Bedote area. And as John mentioned, after the War of 1862, the Dakota-U.S. War, this sacred place of our creation became a place of genocide for our people, as we were held imprisoned there over the winter. So this map really shows beautifully illustrated with some of the Dakota florals that you see are really illustrative of the type of traditional designs that are in our community. And you'll see other design elements like the medicine wheel. And further down to the bottom right of the image, you'll see a woman. Her name is Gray Cloud Woman. And that is Gray Cloud Island. We're working on creating more videos so that we can really fill out the stories of all of these spaces on this map. But we're going to share with you what we have right now. I'd love to start with a video that was created by Marlena Miles, the artist who created this map. And one of the consultants who's worked really closely with our organization at Lower Phalen Creek Project and Wakan Tipi Center, his name is Jim Rock. And he's a historian and also works with star knowledge. And so he and Marlena came together to create this really beautiful visual video about our story for Wakan Tipi, which is a dwelling place of the sacred. This is a Dakota sacred cave site in the city of St. Paul. So, John, if you could start that video, that would be great.
Hamitake api, chandewaste na pech yusapido, ochete shakoing oyate himataha, wamdi hanyetu imaki apido. Damakota, Sisituan, Dakota Himatya. Hello, my relatives. I speak to you today with a glad heart. Offer you my hand. My dad was Sisituan Dakota of the Seven Starfire Nations, Ochetisha Koing Oyate. My name is Jim Rock in English, Wamdi Hayetu, Dakota Ya. I was born at Imanija Ska Ed Himachage. I was born at St. Paul, at near a place called Wakan Tipi, the cave. In which we have the drawings that tell something of our cosmic origins. So what I do is in a planetarium. I was, you know, trained in Western science, but always kept our own ways of thinking here, and the two legs have really come together well in that the word nucleosynthesis, it just means that atoms are made in stars. And we've always said we come from the stars, and to the stars we return. We come from the Earth, and to the Earth we return. The iron in our blood, the carbon in our body, had to come from a sun before this sun. So we're recycled stardust. Star stuff are us, I like to say. The Milky Way is like a river, not just any river, but Hahawakpa or Wakpatanka, Wakpahaska, the big long river, the river of the waterfalls. We find burial mounds near rivers. It's very intentional, it's not random. Our elders, those that have passed on, deserve the highest place near water to go back up to the stars, a place of honor, by the water that flows. Chang, Chang Wakan, Waka Chang, the sacred tree, Sundance tree. The cottonwood tree is filled with stars. That tree full of stars connects between sky and earth along rivers. It likes its feet wet, its roots. It's a bridge between the river down here with sparkling lights on it and the sparkling stars above, the Wanagi Tachanku, the spirit road. It's the road of spirits that we come from and go back to. And we need to be living in a good way so that we go back to that place we come from with integrity, with generosity.
Thanks, John. I love that video. It's so beautiful to visually. It's just so beautiful to watch. You know, part of Wakan Tipi, you'll see. I think it says Ehana Witapi, and that's our. Those are our burial mounds, ancient burial mounds that are really. They look kind of further apart on this map, but in fact, they are the burial mounds are on the bluff above the river, and then at the base of that bluff, along the Mississippi River, is where this Wakan Tipi cave is. So these two sites where these burial mounds that are dated back to more than 2,000 years old, and Wakan Tipi are really one sacred site for Dakota people. But I think, let's see, it's 7:15. Let's do the Bade Makoska video. I really want to share this video because, you know, when we're talking about stories of restoration and care along the Mississippi River, the word restoration means a lot of things, I think, to us. I mean, restoring watershed districts and habitats, but also restoring relationships and place names. Bidemarkowska has been, up until years ago, known as Lake Calhoun, and recently underwent a name restoration to its original Dakota name, Bidemarkowska, which means White Earth Lake. And so this was due to Dakota people, many Native people named places after characteristics of that place. And so the banks of this lake appeared white. And so it was the White Bank or White Earth Lake. So we'll watch this video a little bit about the lake and the restoration of that name.
Spedemakaska. Spedemakaska.
Hamitakuyapi.
Hamitakuyapi.
Timaya hiwo. Come right in.
Hamidakuyapi. Makochek de enana etuampo. Makochek de dakota makoche hecha. Naku. Spedemakaska edun kinaji.
This greeting is Dayan Yahi, and it translates to, it is good you are here. So it's just a greeting for all people that come to this place.
As the Dakota people, we've got our original instructions from the land, from the water, the wind, from this Minnesota Makoche. And so this was always a place of changes, this Bidemarkowska, places that changed, people that changed, the landscape, and today it's still changing.
Dayan Yahi, a welcome greeting for everybody that comes to visit this lake, indigenous, non-indigenous.
Bidemarkowska.
So we're a really small community here in Native communities in general, but here in Minneapolis and St. Paul, we have a small American Indian community. We all tend to know each other. So the little girl in that video is actually in my my first grade daughter's classroom at Bidote Learning Center. And her name is Chanupa. And so just seeing her when she was so little just is so brings me so much joy, but them learning their language and restoring that relationship between our young people and these places, it just gives me an immense amount of hope and pride in the work that we're doing. And I just wanted to mention a little bit, the woman in the video, Angela Two Stars, is a local Dakota artist. And he was describing the Dayan Yahi, which means it's glad you're here. It's a welcome in the Dakota language. And so those were concrete imprints that were in the sidewalks around Bidemarkowska. And this kind of happened, this artwork and creative placemaking was happening after the name was restored to Bidemarkowska. And you know, the importance of restoring these place names really can't be understated, because I think Tracy mentioned this in his brief introduction, just bringing visibility to voices that have been unheard for a long time here in Minnesota. And so projects like name restoration, and this creative placemaking where we can show who we are and share who we are with Dakota people in a contemporary sense here in the Twin Cities, and restoring our relationships with these places is really meaningful, and bringing that visibility and awareness to the community. So, you know, I don't know, John, if you wanted to say more about this work, or I don't know, any other stories before I feel like I'll just start rambling on.
I would love to, but I think I got a note that we need to move on to the next part of the presentation. So I will, I guess, I'm going to put a link to the program we were just looking at in the chat. So those of you who want to can explore it in greater depth. But thank you so much for the opportunity to share this, and we look forward to further conversation.
Thank you all so much. There's so much we're trying to pack into such a short time. So I'm sorry we have to keep it moving, but I'm also very excited to bring on our next presenter, Basia Irland. Basia is a Fulbright scholar. She's an author, a poet, sculptor, installation artist, and an activist who creates international water projects featured in her books, Water Library and Reading the River, the Ecological Activist Art of Basia Irland. These books focus on projects she has created over four decades in Africa, Canada, Europe, South America, Southeast Asia, and the United States. And throughout her work, Irland offers a creative understanding of water while examining how communities of people and plants and animals rely on this vital element. She is a professor emerita in the Department of Art and Art History at the University of New Mexico, where she established the Arts and Ecology program. Her art is featured in over 70 international publications. You can check out some of that on her beautiful, exuberant website. I'm gonna make sure I get that, basiaerland.com, where you'll find blogs about global waterways written for National Geographic. You'll find images from her large retrospective in the Netherlands, extensive projects around the world, including waterborne disease projects, the gathering of waters, which reconnects communities along the entire length of the rivers, and receding, which are hand-carved ephemeral ice books that are embedded with a seed text that are floated downstream to aid with riparian restoration. I know we're gonna hear a little bit more about that project in a bit. So thank you, Basia, for being here to share with us today. I'm going to pull up your first slide. I think that's the right one I have for you. And I'm gonna turn the screen over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, and thanks for that introduction. Can you hear me okay?
You sound great.
Okay. I want to thank all of you, the three of you who were just showing those wonderful videos. I live here in New Mexico, and we have 19 Native American pueblos along the banks of the Rio Grande. So I just want to say welcome to everyone. This is such an important summit, and I appreciate the invitation to speak with you all this evening. Rivers are alive. They have a body called a watershed with a mouth at the delta, organs of wetlands and riparian zones, cells, molecules of water, and like us, a circulatory system. We are not separate from the waters of the world. We each have an external watershed. Mine is the Rio Grande here in New Mexico, but we also have an internal watershed composed of our bodily fluids. Like us, rivers become sick, which is to our detriment since we physically need clean water to survive. Sometimes the sickness is visible, such as when a river becomes a dumping ground for toxins and plastic pollution. Other times the river's illness can't be seen, but tests reveal waterborne diseases only visible through a microscope. And I've studied a lot of waterborne diseases and done a lot of projects around the world on those. Thankfully, global rivers are slowly being recognized as living beings with the same rights as a person, as we heard from some of the wonderful discussions earlier today from the panelists. I have blogged for National Geographic with essays about international rivers that are written in the first person from the perspective of the water. Rivers have accumulated deep knowledge to teach us about living on this earth. My entire career has been devoted to international freshwater issues, and today I will share just two series of projects I have been working on for many years. So the image that you're seeing here is the backpack repository that was built to accompany the gathering of waters along the entire 1,875 mile length of the Rio Grande. as it travels through Colorado, New Mexico, and becomes the border between Texas and Mexico. This project took 5 years, and I wish I had several hours to just talk about this project. We were handing a canteen or a river vessel, person to person, all the way along those almost 2,000 miles from the headwaters in Colorado until we reached the Gulf of Mexico at Boca Chica. The emphasis of this international gathering of water series of projects is on collaborative and locally based actions encompassing an ethic of inclusion that focuses on important scientific and artistic outcomes along rivers. Diverse participants, including farmers and biologists and mayordomos, politicians, tribal members, artists, students of all ages, extend a hand to someone upstream, receive the canteen, also called the river vessel, add their own small contribution of water from the river right in the logbook, and pass these along to another person downstream. When the canteen vessel reaches the end of the river, whether at the Gulf or the ocean, a sound or a confluence, participants release the mingled waters during the ceremony, offering gratitude and respect. Most discussions about rivers occur indoors in a classroom or boardroom, or as we're all experiencing these long days on Zoom meetings. However, the gathering of waters projects occur physically at the river so that we can all experience the water firsthand. People who meet at the river during these projects are still working together today. The sculptural backpack repository, constructed from local materials, contains scientific data, water analysis, hydrographs, watershed maps, photographs, and video documentaries. It is imperative for all of us that we find ways to protect and honor our rivers. This is the repository for the Nisqually River Gathering of Waters in Washington State, where we work closely with the Nisqually tribe. The backpack is constructed from local cedar wood. The Nisqually is the only river in the United States that starts at a national park and ends in a wildlife refuge. It begins on Mount Rainier and flows into Puget Sound. This backpack was built using recycled truck inner tubes because tubing along Boulder Creek, Colorado is a great sport during the summer. And you'll see at the bottom there are 31 glass vials denoting the length of the river that are attached to the backpack, and these make a lovely sound as it's worn. We will now watch a 4-minute film about another international project detailing how hand-carved ice books are embedded with seeds as a way to help restore riparian zones. We need sound.
Myra, if you'd like me to try for mine, I can do that.
Ice receding, books receding, emphasizes the necessity of communal effort, scientific knowledge, and artistic expression to deal with the complex issues of climate disruption and watershed restoration by releasing seed-laden ephemeral ice sculptures into rivers. The idea for the ice books began in 2007 when I was invited to do a project along Boulder Creek in Boulder, Colorado, as part of an exhibition focused on ecological issues. The primary water source for Boulder is Arapaho Glacier, and that glacier, as with most others in the world, is drastically melting. Carving ice made this idea visible and tangible so that people can viscerally have a sense of loss. At the same time, I wanted to embed something positive within the ice, which were the seeds. The process of carving the ice books begins with simple blocks of ice. Some of the largest ones have weighed up to 300 pounds. I sculpt both the form of a closed book and an open book, where the seed texts form sentences and paragraphs. I work with stream ecologists, biologists, and botanists to ascertain the best native seeds for each riparian zone. With the help of local communities, the ice books are launched into the water. As they float downstream, the seeds are released and begin to plant themselves along the banks of the river. In the years since the first ice book project in Colorado, I have been invited to numerous locations around the world and have created over 100 hand-carved ice books to bring attention to rivers and how we might help with restoration efforts. In recent years, I have begun to invite international friends to create their own ice books as a way to help connect people to their watersheds and initiate restorative actions that address local ecological issues. The global results have been totally amazing, inventive, and inspiring, with examples coming in from Hawaii, Spain, France, England, the Navajo Nation. Scientists in Ladakh, India, are involved, as are grade school children in Arizona. A professor in China organized a two-day workshop with adults and children and launched the ice books into the confluence of the Jialing and Yangtze rivers. The River Dart ice book in Devon, England, focuses on species loss and the collapse of amphibian populations. A Dutch ice book witnesses a dredged river to help alleviate flooding. A frozen tome in Sydney, Australia, is embedded with mangrove seedlings. If you visit your local river today, what would you add to an ice book to bring attention to ecological issues faced by your watershed?
A few words about this film. Plants are super important to riparian zones because they sequester carbon, they mitigate floods and drought, they pollinate other plants, disperse seeds, create soil regeneration and preservation, act as filters for pollutants and debris, supply leaf litter for food and habitat, promote aesthetic pleasure, hold the banks in place to slow erosion, and provide shelter shade for riverside organisms, including humans. Also, I just want to add that for all of my projects, I create small gifts for the hundreds of participants in these projects because I believe in reciprocity, and all of these volunteers have donated their time and energy and enthusiasm to making these river events a reality. As we have just seen in the film, these ice books provide a model that can be replicated along any creek, stream, or river. So this is an invitation. If any of you would like to create your own ice book in your community, and we've heard over the past 3 days, people from all around the world, please email me, and somebody can put my email in the chat box. Also, you could, I think somebody in the chat box, I can't see it right now, put my website, which is basiaerland.com, to view many of my other freshwater projects. So I'd like to end with this quote by Tanaka Shozo. The care of rivers is not a question of rivers, but of the human heart. Thank you.
Basia, thank you so much.